Bikini Atoll and first films of Baker Day, the underwater explosion of the fifth atomic bomb. Grouped in the target area of the lagoon are 75 ships and 12 lesser craft. In the center of the 30 square mile area, the bomb will be detonated. Aboard the LSM-60, the bomb-carrying vessel, last-minute preparations. The yoke flag is hoisted, signal for evacuation. Now scientists have completed their work of setting the complex electrical circuits. The group is headed by Dr. Marshall Holloway, leader of the Los Alamos laboratory, who will explode the bomb. Previously from the LSM, a caisson carrying the bomb was lowered by super winches. It is probably some 40 feet below. Aboard the Los Alamos firing ship, the laboratory vessel, the work of months nears its climax. One of the last steps is completed as circuits are locked, the transmitter switch set. Five radio control circuits will set off the blast in this prelude to push-button warfare. With Dr. Ernest Titterton, his technical advisor, Dr. Holloway takes over at the panel of the controls that will flash the impulse to detonate the explosion. The bomb and instruments are set into action. Throughout the entire area, nerves are stretched to the breaking point. Cameras are grinding. Titterton calls out the time signals. Just 1/2 minute to go. Holloway presses the button that in just 30 seconds will produce the explosion.
Ten. Five, four, three, two, one, fire.
Boiling tower of water, from 5 to 10 million tons of water. In 2.5 minutes, it rose an entire mile in the sky. Below is a deadly bank of radioactive cloud and steam, some 2,000 feet in height. Observation ships could not go in for many hours. Water is checked for radioactivity. Geiger counters rattle wildly. The area is loaded with death-dealing gamma, neutron, and other lethal rays. And there is no complete protection against this terrifying invisible killer. Aboard the McKinley, Admiral Blandy approaches the target ships. 2 days after the blast, the area was still heavily contaminated. At first, there seemed to be little damage, but succeeding days told a different story. The test indicates all ships within 500 yards of an underwater blast would be seriously damaged. The Independent, still scarred from the July 1st atomic blast, is listing. Some 7 hours after the explosion, the famed aircraft carrier the Saratoga goes down. In her battlecruiser hull, the ship had maximum watertight integrity. 11 vessels in all went to the bottom. These films were made by Army, Navy, Marine Corps, Coast Guard, and newsreel cameramen. Now, another camera angle. A solid wall of radioactive steam sweeps over the target fleet. Any personnel aboard would surely have met death, the terrible atomic death that 1 year ago swept down on Hiroshima. Hiroshima, August 5th, 1945, just 1 year ago. Jap air raid watchers were on the lookout just before the first atomic bomb shattered the thought of the entire world. Then from out of the sky, this was how Hiroshima looked after the blast. 4.5 square miles almost completely burned out. These films, which were made by the Japanese immediately after the explosion and only now released, tell a grim and horrific story. Hospitals were the scenes of some of the most terrifying chapters. 30% of the population was dead. Another 30% were seriously injured. Only 3 of Hiroshima's hospitals were usable. Signs of radiation were everywhere. On walls, the backs of chairs. The radiation marks of a ladder. The design of this woman's dress was imprinted on her skin. 70 to 80,000 were killed. An equal number injured. In the wake of the atomic bomb come flash burns and death-dealing radiation effects. No exact definition of the killing power of radiation can yet be given. But these shocking films speak for themselves. This is the same power that was unleashed in the bikini tests. Bombs that were far from duds. This soldier is blind. This man's ears are almost completely burned off. Atomic warfare spares no one, not even little children. Today, 1 year after the first bomb exploded, its scars remain. In this Hiroshima schoolroom, children still carry souvenirs of the bomb's terrible power to deface and destroy. And instead of Hiroshima, this might have been Chicago, San Francisco, New York, or any town. The battle to save mankind from destroying itself through this terrible power in what would be the most frightful war of all time is still deadlocked. Same old balance of power maneuvering continues. But our survival depends upon our solution of the problem of atomic power. Scientists who brought atomic power into being and who may yet convert it into amazing new uses for good seem as impotent as the rest of us. America, however, has proposed an international authority to control atomic power. Russia has proposed another plan. But it is later than we think, and there is still no agreement. Unless there is complete international agreement on the bomb, we may as well build our cities under the earth and get ready for Armageddon. For atomic power is only in its infancy. Every conference, treaty, and organization is meaningless unless we solve this decisive problem of the world's future.